The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content.
Today my presentation will be about monitoring of the longest precast pretension girders that ever fabricated in the United States, which is part of the Alaskan Way Viaduct in Seattle, Washington. The co-authors from my paper are from two parties. The first one, which is the Washington State DOT. I have the state bridge engineer, Bijan Khali'i, and the design engineer, Anthony Mizumori. And from the precast concrete fabrication plant, which is the Concrete Technology Corporation, I have David Chapman and Steve Sigurant. First, I want to acknowledge the people who have helped me to put the plan together and build the system, people from Washington DOT and from the precast plant, CTC. Also, I would like to acknowledge the financial support from PCI and from my university, George Washington University. Where I am local. My university is in downtown Washington, D.C., and the bridge is on the other side of the country, which is about 2,000 miles away. So the only way for us to collect data and keep analyzing them is to receive these data wireless. Objectives of this study are two objectives. The first one, to study the effect of the deck shrinkage on the pre-stress losses and on the girder behavior in general. Second, to study the concrete stresses at and around the harping point. The second objective over here is a little bit unique to Washington State, because if you are familiar with the Washington State details for pretension girders, they lump the strands. Every six strands in the web at the bottom flange, they lumped them between the mid-span point and the harping point. And starting from the harping point, they start to spread out towards the end face of the member. So they were a little bit worried about the stresses at this point. Just a brief background about the project. This project, which is the Alaskan Way Viaduct, this project consists of several subtasks, including the total replacement of State 99 route, which is goes north to south, close to the bay, which is over here. And actually, this area is a very critical area because the port for Seattle is over here, and they have all of the railroad that carries the freight from the port to Seattle area is going underneath this bridge. The span that I have investigated over here is one of the spans which is close to the south end, and this span 2C. This span actually is 201 feet between center line of the abutment to center line of the abutment. This is the intersection which is underneath the bridge. We have the railroad in the middle, and then we have a couple of lanes on the right and on the left for traffic. They have another small lane over here for bikes and another lane for pedestrian. So this is a very congested and very busy intersection. This picture I have taken it from top of the span to see. And as you can tell over here, this is a railroad which is coming exactly under the bridge. This is a picture about the span from a distance. As you can tell over here, each time they have a new girder coming to the construction site, they have to shut down the intersection fully, and then after they install the girder and secure it in place, they open the intersection for traffic. If you notice, the bridge was built in two phases. The right-hand side over here, which is carrying the traffic right now, is phase number one. And this is phase number two, which I have worked on it. Actually, for phase number one, I have done a lot of work with the state DOT for the end zone cracking. We have a very nice paper in PCI, which received the Milton P. Award for papers in PCI this year. So I'm going to concentrate on phase number two, and in phase number two, I have instrumented four girders. First girder, second girder, number five, and number six for this study. So these are the four girders that I have instrumented. The cross-section girder, the cross-section of the girder that is used on this span is the deepest girder that Washington State has in its library, which is 100 inch deep, which is a little bit over 8 feet. This girder for this span was pre-stressed with total 80.6 inch strands. 46 of them are straight in the bottom flange, and then 26 harped strands at 2 points, and then in the top flange they have 8 strands which are temporary, which are cut after the girder is installed on the bridge. The total weight of this girder, by the way, is about 120-125 tons. In order to monitor the strains in the girder and in the deck, we have two types of materials that we need to monitor. The first one is the stress in the strand, and the other one will be strains in the concrete. In order to monitor these gauges for a period between 2 to 4 years, is our plan. We need to have a very reliable gauges. This is why we have used the vibrating wire gauges. For the strands, we have used the strand meter, and for the measuring the strains in the concrete, we have used the rebar strain meter, which is a separate piece of rebar, which is about 6 feet long, and the gauge is in the middle. How many total number of gauges we have on the bridge? I have 32 gauges, and at every mid-span point and harping point of these four girders, I have four gauges. These four gauges are as follow. At the bottom, I have two rebar strain meters and one rebar strain meter at the top. These three gauges over here to measure strain in the concrete. And for the stand, I was not allowed by the precast producer and by the state DOT to put any gauges in any of the internal strands because this is a very tight spacing over here. They worried about my safety when I started installing these gauges on the strand. So we picked the corner bottom strand over here, which is accessible before they put the side form on the reinforcement. How to route the cables for these gauges? I was not allowed to add any holes or sleeves through the web, and I was not allowed to send any cables to the bottom surface of the girder. So the only way that I have to take all of these cables, pass them through the web of the girder, and get them outside from the top surface of the girder. This is a picture during the installation of the girders. This is the strand meter, and these are two of the concrete rebar strain meters. And as you can tell over here, these are the bundle of the cable. For sure, we are going to get it and pass it through the web. Between the time of releasing the strands and taking these girders and installing them on the bridge, the only way to measure the strains in the girder was manual. So I was using this manual read box, and imagine with me that I have 32 gauges that I have to connect them one by one with this box and then take the measurement almost on daily basis. So actually this kind of project was a little bit labor intensive in the beginning. Today I don't have to do anything. You will see that I am using wireless connection and fully automated data collection system. I have a video over here to show you about how the shipping of the girder was a big hassle. This is 205-foot long piece of concrete, which weighs about 120 tons. Each time they are moving one of these girders from the precast fabrication plant to the construction site, they have to shut down the highway. So most of the time they were moving these girders during night. In order to measure the strains in the girders, I have a big problem how to collect this data, and I need to have the system fully working before the concrete of the slab is cast. So this was the challenge. I have to have the system fully working 1 or 2 days before the slab was cast. These were the limitations that were set on me by the state DOT and the fabricator. Number one, for the girders, I can't put any more holes in the web or anywhere. Number two, for the health monitoring system box, it has to be self-powered. I am not allowed to use the power which is already in the barrier, which is providing power for the light poles. Number two, number three, I have to have a wireless data collection system. So in this case, I am not allowed to go and visit and open this box and collect the data. Finally, I have to keep the bridge aesthetic. So if I am going to put anything on the bridge, it has to be very small and nobody will notice it. So how did we use it? How did we make it? It was very simple. We have about 3 or 4 scenarios I provided to the Washington DOT, and they picked this one. We are going to hang on the barrier over here our health monitoring system box, and all of the cables that are coming from the top surface of these 4 girders, I am going to pass the cable between the 2 top and bottom meshes of the slab, and I'm getting outside to the cantilever area and then connected with the HMS box. So this is the plan over here. We have all of the cables coming from the top surface of the girders. I'm going to pass it until I reach the cantilever area. And I have to get all of these cables to the downside of the platform and then take it up to my box. So this is the final plan over here. All of the cables are coming to the downside of the platform. And then we have provided them through a flexible pipe, and then it takes it to the HMS box. The size of the box was very small. I think it was about 4 feet by 3 feet, and I have to accommodate all of the equipment inside this box. So what I have inside this box, I have the data logger, which is provided with a wireless circuit, and then I have a multiplexer over here in order to add to me another 16 channels. So total, I have 32 channels available with this system. And in order to power this system, I have used over here a heavy duty marine battery, and this battery for sure it's not gonna last more than a week. So I have connected this battery with a photocell in order to charge it when we have the sunlight. So the system by itself, by this battery and by the solar panel, is self-automated and self-sustained. So this is the solar panel, which is put next to the box. The problem right now during the construction of the slab, where we can put this box, we have asked the contractor in order to extend the platform that is used over here to cast the cantilever part of the bridge, to extend the platform for us, and this is where I have put my box. So this is the picture from underneath, and you can tell that we have 2 flexible pipes over here which are taking the cables and sending them to the HMS box. This is the picture from the top of the bridge, and I have a big problem because I have to arrange with the contractor and with the iron people to come exactly after they put the bottom mesh of the reinforcement. And the window for this type of project, it was about 30 minutes. I have to come during these 30 minutes and stretch my cables. Unfortunately, I missed these 30 minutes. I was on the highway, and there was some traffic jam, so I couldn't reach the bridge at that time. And when I arrived over there, I have found that they already have the top mesh of the reinforcement. Now I have to take all of these 30 cables one by one and thread them between these 2 layers of reinforcement. This was one of the toughest jobs that I have done in my whole life. It was in mid-July, it was very hot, and it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and they were going to cast the concrete next day. So this was the only time for me to do it. By the end, once we get all of the cables close to where we are going to send it to the other side of the platform, we bundle them in two bundles, one which is coming from the Harping Point, another one on this side which is coming from the Midspan Point. So this is the picture from underneath. Again, all of the cables are coming through the flexible pipe to the HMS box. This is one bundle, and this is the other bundle from the other side. What are the challenges that we have found? The first one, as I told you, that picking the right time to stretch my cable, it was not easy to organize it with the iron people. Number two, the size of the box itself. As I said before in the very beginning, Washington State DOT asked me to use the smallest box that I can use. And this is the price that I paid for it. I have right now 30 cables that are coming in a very tight area over here that I need to fit them to the multiplexer and to the data logger, and it was really a tough job. The other concern that I have, which is the ID tags that I have on the cables. I have to stretch some of these cables from the center girder, which is about 50 feet away from the box, so I was a little bit worried that I may lose the ID tag on the cables, but thank God that I didn't lose any of them. Until the last moment before they cast the concrete for the slab, I was there and I was doing modification to the system. For example, this picture you may see that the solar panel right now we have get it down. Why? Because 30 minutes before the slab was cast, they told me that the screed machine is cantilevering directly over my box and it's going to hit the solar panel. So I have to get it down. So after they take off all of the forms after the slab was cast, I asked them to keep the extended part and in order to take the box and put it on the final framing support. I told them to do it in two steps. Don't do it at the same time that you are stripping your form. You may hurt our system. So the way that they have done it, they left this part of the extended platform. They shut down the intersection over here. We came with the crane. We carried the box, and then they remove all of the platform over here, and then they put finally the steel framing brackets that is going to support the system. If you go over there and from a distance, this is what you will notice, that there is a small thing that is hanging out from the barrier. If you come very close, this is what you are going to see over there. Since I have put this box in its final position until today, it was more than 2 years right now, it was back in July 2012, until today nobody has visited this box or opened it, and I was able to receive all of the data wirelessly from my office in Washington DC without any interruption. So this was the picture of the bridge at that time in September 2012. They have partially opened this span to traffic. Half of it was open to traffic. September 2014, this is the picture right now. Phase number two is fully open to traffic, and the box is still there, and I'm still able to collect the data. This is a picture of one of the charts that I have developed in order to analyze the data. Unfortunately, I'm not going to report on the data and its analysis today. Hopefully, next year, maybe we'll have some of the analysis available for you. But all of the gauges, surprisingly, 32 gauges, all of them are working perfectly until today. This is more than 2 years, and we'll continue collecting this data for another 2 years. Thank you.